Hello everyone, welcome to Money Map. Today is a special edition. We deliberately put this together to really speak to the issue of cryptocurrency, because since the ban of cryptocurrency by the CBN, we've been seeing several, we've heard several comments, and it appears to us that people really don't understand where this all came from and what it's all about. So our job is not to say you should deal with cryptocurrency or not at this juncture, but we feel everybody needs to have an understanding of how this came to be and where it may be headed. So before we go further, please hit the subscribe button on this channel and just do that right now. Okay, thank you. So let's get to the meat of the matter. We have to understand currency or money first from the historical perspective of using precious metals like gold and silver. So we had in the US, they have what we called gold standard. So the first time paper money was printed in the US was 1861, and they made the law, the Gold Standard Act, that fixes the power of the value of gold to at $20.67 approximately. So based on that, people could move around with paper money, and it's easy to transport. Of course, gold is quite heavy, so you could move around, and that's really helped commerce and business. And most importantly, that we must know is that you could exchange your paper money with gold. So you have gold deposit with bank. And so instead of you carrying the gold about, you have your paper money that you could take out and do transaction, because everybody knows that there is a corresponding gold somewhere in a bank inside the vault. Then the only criticism for gold at that time was that price could be volatile. Maybe when they discover a new mine, they'll just see a little volatility, maybe it goes up, but usually single digits. They don't used to have this hyperinflation or double digits inflation, because everything is tied to gold. So that was how it was running at that time. Then later down the line, in the US, they made another law, 1934, the Gold Reserve Act, which was made by the President Roosevelt. So what they did, they took away all the gold from citizens, all the gold deposits and tied to. The government took it over by force. They took it over by force and paid them $20.67 in exchange. And as soon as they did that, which was quite controversial at that time, because the government failed to meet their obligation on gold redemption. Remember, we said that you could exchange your paper currency with gold. So there's always a physical gold that is backing your paper currency. So the government could not meet their obligation. So instead, they forcefully took over the gold. And this was not only the US. In other climes, even in the UK, they were forcefully taking over this precious metal. Now, as soon as they took over at $20.67, they revalued it to $35 per ounce, so they just made automatic profit. So what they did then was that you could not sell, nobody was allowed to sell gold anymore. And so, but the government can buy, if you have gold, they can buy from you. And so when they buy from you, they sell to only foreign monetary authorities, like foreign central banks, and maybe a few licensed users. So it was highly controlled, and the government gained control over the monetary system. Now, fast forward to after the Second World War, 1944, much of Europe was destroyed, bombings and all this destruction during the war. So many countries needed to rebuild their country, reconstruct everything. And one of the options that was faced that they had was that they should devalue their currency, since many of them were quite productive. They felt they should devalue their currency. And so the US again came together, rallied everybody out, and they had a meeting at Bretton Woods in the US, and they agreed that. So 44 countries participated in that meeting, and they agreed that, you know what, you don't need to devalue your currency. If you are in Nigeria, you will think devaluation is a bad thing. No, Devaluation is a good thing if you are producing, you are exporting. It's a bad thing if you are importing because you need more money to import. But for many of these European countries that were really devastated by the war, Germany, France, United Kingdom, they were really productive. So devaluation was a good option for them, which is seen as an uncompetitive practice in international trade. So instead of that, they came together that, okay, let's form a financial institution, a central financial institution. So instead of you dividing your currency, this financial institution will be lending you money to build, to rebuild. So they created the IMF for the developed countries and also created World Bank for the developing countries. So these institutions will be financing all the rebuilding efforts. So part of the agreement at the Bretton Woods was that the participating countries, they deposited all their gold with the IMF and were physically located in the US. But because of the policy of the US, since they make their own law that they were always buying gold from people. So gold moved to the US because US was paying more, about over $35. They were paying more for anybody else anyway. So the best place to sell your gold was US, and you sell it to the treasury. And so at that time, US had 75% of the world's gold reserve. And that gave them the claim to become the world reserve currency. So everybody, all the participating countries came together, they gave their gold to the IMF, and they agreed on a fixed exchange rate with the IMF. So that's how dollar became the currency that everybody must. So you drop your gold. So the dollar, you drop your gold with the IMF, then your currency is fixed to the dollar. Why dollar is backed by gold. Now, but later down the line, there were signs of trouble. The US economy was really suffering. They have what we call stagflation. Don't mind the big English. It just means they have inflation and recession at the same time. Meanwhile, in the international space, the dollar was appreciating. Why? Because they supposedly have the gold. So people were always looking for the dollar. But back home, the domestic economy had problems. And in the build up to that time, the US government was printing money to finance their needs. So they had money which was supposed to be backed by gold, but they kept printing money to build, to finance, build infrastructure and doing that. And so that actually affected the purchasing power, the amount of goods that the money can buy. So the other government that deposited gold with them realized that something was going on. So they started redeeming their gold. Say, okay, give us my gold back and give me my money. Yeah, take your money, give me back my gold. And that was a problem for the US. So instead of them to stop the printing, they kept on printing, and suddenly they just canceled the Bretton Woods system that was backed by gold. And that's how, since that time, the US dollar that everybody wants to keep is backed by nothing other than your faith and confidence in the US and its economy. There's no gold anywhere, it's just paper, and they keep on printing the paper. So if you are holding the US dollar, which you have always done, we are doing so because we have faith in it, nothing else. Now, let's look at something that may be surprising to a few people. There's something called US Debt Clock. Actually, this is a live website. You can visit this website, usdebtclock.org. You'll be amazed at the volume of debts that the US have been building up over the years. Look at the national debt, $27 trillion. Look at debt per citizen, $84,229 per citizen in the US. Debt by taxpayer, you can see their tax revenue, just 3.4 trillion revenue per citizen. So this is interesting. If you divide the total revenue generated in the economy by the number of citizens, you have 10,466. But debt per citizen, 84,229. You can see the disparity. So a lot of people are looking at this, and that this is a country that has the history of, you know, reneging an agreement, collecting people's gold by force. When it doesn't pay them, they start printing and they say, look, we cannot trust these people. So this is why people started looking for alternatives, something that they can, that will not be under the control of a central government. And this is what, you know, gave birth to what we have in the name of blockchain. So people don't trust the system, the central government. During this pandemic, the US government has given intervention funds about first $3 trillion. Another one has been approved at $1.9 trillion. And people are asking, where are you getting all this money from? Look at debts everywhere. So they are just creating money out of thin air that they don't have and giving it to people. And people are saying, you know what? Let me start putting my money elsewhere. So that's why the price of gold has been, the price of gold has been increasing in recent times because people don't have confidence in the dollar. They feel that it's going to lose value. And so they would rather keep gold. And those who now understand keep gold or cryptocurrencies. So those who understand how cryptocurrency works, they were moving to it. So it's all about trust. So we always talk about cryptocurrency, but cryptocurrency is not even the issue. It's the technology that backs it up, which is the blockchain technology. It's the technology that builds trust because one, there's no central authority. So everybody is involved. If any transaction that is going to take place, any record must be recorded across all the participants in the blockchain. So everybody is seeing what you are doing. You can't just wake up and print money on the blockchain or update a record on the blockchain. That record will be seen by all participants on the blockchain. And the application is so far reaching. It's not about money alone. Money, anything. If you are in Nigeria and you know about Lagos, you have heard several instances of the government issuing certificate of occupancy to more than one person, and you'll be surprised. How is it possible? Why? Because even the central database, which we are supposed to trust, the central reporting system is compromised. And we are saying, and they are saying that, look, let's use digital technology to safeguard all these things so that we don't have people, a central government messing us up anymore. So blockchain came to address trust issue, currency be one, and many other aspects of society. People want to see what is happening. So a major difference between blockchain and a traditional database system is that, so you will have a company that has a server, and only the company knows how they update their records and process information. But blockchain says, no, if I'm part of this system, let me see what you are adding. Let me know what you are adding or delete. You cannot delete. You can only add. And if you are adding, everybody is seeing what you are adding at the same time. Imagine. So it's a different thing. We'll be addressing the technicalities, how technology enforces trust through the blockchain in our subsequent videos or programs. Now, let's look at something. Countries that have adopted blockchain. You will be surprised. These are the top 10 countries in the world. What do you notice? Ukraine, Russia, Venezuela, Kenya, China, Nigeria is number 8. Top 10 countries in the world that have adopted cryptocurrencies. In exception of the United States or maybe China, what do you notice? These are all countries, developing countries that have serious trust deficit. These are countries that people don't have trust in their government. They know the government will come out and say A, meanwhile the case is B. So they are looking for alternatives. So you can see that this thing is all about trust. People want something that they can rely upon, and they are not getting it from their politician. You see Kenya on the list, you see Venezuela, you see South Africa, Colombia, Vietnam. These are all countries that the government has failed, right? Now, how is crypto? So the idea of cryptocurrency or blockchain, how is it going to be adopted? Look, this is hard to swallow, but if you are above 40 years, you may not appreciate what is going on. But guess what? It is not you that will drive this thing. So what you can do if you are above 40 years is to just sit down and look at this issue from the perspective of someone born before, from 1980. And look, so let me look at the active population and labor force group for the whole world. What do you notice? Over about 40 million people, they are within 15 to 24 age bracket. followed by the 25 to 34 age bracket. Remember, millennials are people born between 1980 and 2000. These are the people who are going to drive this adoption. So if you are above that level, you may be saying, oh, this thing is fake, this thing is this, but these are, you are not, it's not your generation that is going to drive this thing. And so this thing will move on. And one thing about the old, so if we are using the US dollar because of faith, why do you think people will not use cryptocurrency because of faith? Meanwhile, it's not even like the fiat money, which is money issued by government, that they can wake up and print anytime. The blockchain protocols is so stringent, you can't mint coin. So they call the process of creating money on blockchain, they call it minting. You can't mint it just like that and wake up. It takes a considerable effort to do so. Serious effort and investment in servers, in computers, in power generation to do it. So it is not like the fiat money. But what we are saying is that you have to understand demographics to know what is going to happen. So what happened, what we have been seeing is that since Bitcoin was launched in 2009, a lot of people were skeptics. But as time goes on, they are winning new, there are new converts, because the younger ones who are driving it, they understand technology. They are ready to research it. And you can see the age distribution. People above 45, they are just few compared to those within Generation Z, 15 to 24 years, and 25 to 34 years, 35 to about 44 years. So they are the people who are going to drive this thing. And you have to understand the way they think, their own orientation. Millennials are confident, ambitious, they are achievement-oriented, they are curious. Generation Z, if you were born after year 2000, we are in 2021 now, so that person is about 21 years, so they are totally different. They value freedom and independence, they are financial focused, they are entrepreneurial. These people don't want to go to any office and resume their 8 a.m. and resume their day and close 5 a.m. No. They want to be able to work from their laptop and you get them paid. They want to come to your office maybe Wednesday or Thursday and they are doing something on Instagram. They don't have time for all those rubbish that generations before them were doing. So they are focused and they are going to drive this thing. If you are in doubt that they are going to drive this thing, let's look at the most valuable companies today. Amazon, Google, Apple, Microsoft, Samsung, International Bank of China, Facebook, Walmart, Ping An, Huawei. Lisa, look at their value. Who are the people driving this? Who are the people that shop on Amazon? It's not my grandmother, certainly. Who are the people on Google? Not my dad, who is above 70. No, it is these people. Who are the people using Apple? Who are the people on Microsoft, Samsung, Facebook? Who are the people on Facebook? But you can see within a short time, these countries, there was no Facebook 25 years ago, but look at how it has grown in value. So why do you think, so many of the government, you have the older people in charge of the government, we are going to ban this, we are going to ban that. But the users, those who want this, they say, we want it, we love it. So that's the problem. So you can use state power and this and that, but the technology is even beyond many of these state actors. And the people who want it, they want it, they are embracing it, they are adopting it. And so what we are finding recently is that the institutional investors who stood by before, they are now coming in. Big Wall Street investment firms, they are coming to this thing. So if you say cryptocurrency is useless, is shit coin, is a trash coin, is yeye coin, you are right. Because you know what? Even the US dollar is backed by faith. The naira you are spending is backed by faith. It's just a piece of paper. I will give you a piece of, if you are a car dealer, I will give you a piece of paper. You will give me a brand new car. But really, how much does it cost to print those pieces of paper? What's the real value of paper? It's nothing compared to the car. But the reason you are accepting it is because you have trust in that another person will accept it from you and that the government issued it. But if the millennials have not gathered together and used technology to build trust, why do you think the cryptocurrencies will not be adopted? It's going to be because it is what you believe it is, and they believe that this thing works for us and they are going to use it. So that is what it is. So if you say it's useless, you are right. But whilst you are saying that, those who really need and embrace it, they will continue embracing and it will be rising in value as they go on. In 2009, in 2010, a Bitcoin was not enough to buy donuts. But now you are talking of almost $48,000 for one. Why? Adoption has been increasing over the years. So you, whatever position you hold, just know that the trade is moving on. Thank you. So we have a cryptocurrency program, training program, because it's knowledge intensive. And we also have our mentorship program, which can we also cover the cryptocurrency mentorship program, IMAP. Please use this link. The link here is also provided in the description, and join IMAP, and you will be able to learn and with real life situations on a daily basis. And the mentorship program covers a period of 1 year. Thank you for listening. God bless and have a nice day.